Well, good morning, folks, and welcome to our pre-recorded service for Sunday, the 16th of May. You're all very welcome here as we gather online virtually to worship the Lord together. We are a church family at High Street, and we do this because we want to worship God. The Bible instructs us to do this, to set aside one day each week, the Lord's Day, to meet with each other for praise, for prayer, and for studying God's Word. But we also do it because it's our joy and our privilege. It's not just our duty. It's not just another task that needs to be done in our busy lives. Rather, we come here to give thanks to God and to praise Him for all that He has done for us and all He continues to do for us. Psalm 48 describes the wonder of God. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. In the city of our God, his holy mountain, beautiful in its loftiness, the joy of the whole earth. And Psalm 47 gives us the words to use to praise him. Clap your hands, all you nations. Shout to God with cries of joy. For the Lord Most High is awesome. The great king over all the earth. He subdued nations under us, peoples under our feet. He chose our inheritance for us, the pride of Jacob, whom he loved. Sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises to our king, sing praises. For God is the king of all the earth. Sing to him a psalm of praise. God reigns over the nations. God is seated on his holy throne. He is greatly exalted. Folks, whatever kind of week you've had, today, right now, is an opportunity to sit at the feet of Jesus, to bring our thanksgiving, our worries, our concerns to him, and to praise the name of the Lord. We're going to begin our service by singing together the wonderful hymn, How Deep the Father's Love for Us.
His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain? Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
Shall we pray together? Father God, this morning we join with hearts and voices all over our nation, and in fact all around the world, who are gathering to worship you. Today is the Lord's Day, and we come as your people to honour you and give you praise. No matter what our individual situation is, no matter what our circumstances are, no matter if we've had a wonderful week or a week of tears and frustration, Lord, we ask that you would come and make your presence known to each one of us. For those who need encouragement and loving kindness, we ask that you draw closer than ever before. For those who need rebuke and challenge, we ask that you penetrate our hearts. For those who need guilt removed, we ask that you cleanse with your mercy and grace. For those who long to serve you and find joy in you, we ask that you provide zeal, courage, and opportunity. For those who have grown cold or hard in heart, we pray that the warmth of your love would descend upon us. Father, for all of us, we bring our prayers of confession before you now. We recognize our own weakness. We admit our wrongdoing. We have sinned against you and you alone. Merciful Father, forgive us. And as we confess, we cling to your promise of grace and forgiveness. Thank you for Jesus, the one whose death sealed our freedom, the one who has removed our sin as far as the east is from the west. And we thank you for the rest and for the joy we can find in him. He invites each of us to come to you. So give us humility in our hearts that we might set aside any pride or stubbornness and be willing to come as we are, not trying to be something that we're not. Father, reveal yourself to us and minister to us this morning, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, folks, I just wanted to mention one or two announcements here very quickly. This Wednesday, we'll be gathering for prayer, and we're continuing to do this online. So those of you at home, you'll be able to join us if you're able to use Zoom. So the details of the Zoom call on Wednesday night are in the description box just below this, but I'll also email them out to you. So it's Wednesday night, 7:30 as normal for a time of prayer. Next Sunday, our morning service as normal is at 10:30. Again, it's in the church building, but we'll also provide stuff online for those who can't make it. And just one final thing to say, very soon we're hoping to launch a bit of a membership course for anyone who wants to become a recognized member of our church family. We're hoping to be able to do this in person in the church. So safely with all the social distancing stuff in place and the protocols. But it may have to be online. We're just not sure yet. But if you have recently started maybe tuning in online or maybe even coming along to our church over the past year or so, or maybe you're someone who's been away for a while and has returned, then this is something I'd love you to consider. It's three sessions, probably just an hour each, and we have a bit of a look at what it means to be a believer in our church and what it means to be part of this church specifically. So have a think about that. Maybe you can let me know in person or via email or give me a call even if you're interested in coming along to that. And there'll be more information in the next week or so about when and where that's happening. Okay, those are all the announcements. We'll actually join our hearts in prayer again here as we bring our prayers of intercession. before the Lord. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, what a privilege it is for us to pray to you, to come before your throne of grace and pour out our hearts. Your word encourages us to come to you, to ask, to seek, and to knock. And so this morning we do that very thing. Firstly, Lord, we thank you for your goodness and protection that has surrounded us since the start of the pandemic last year. You've kept us safe from harm. We owe you our lives. Thank you for the hospital staff who have worked tirelessly to help those in need. Thank you for the vaccine program that has rolled out so efficiently in our country. And thank you that restrictions are now easing, allowing us maybe to see family and friends more often. But Lord, we do want to continue to pray for countries like India, where things are just nowhere near as positive. We pray that you would bring about a change in their circumstances. We pray that vaccines would be supplied and rolled out. We pray that hospital care would be given to those who need it. We pray that those in poverty would be supported and not just forgotten about. We pray that this variant of COVID that exists in India would not become a huge problem all over the world, but rather be limited in its spread. And Lord, we also pray that you would strengthen your church there to play their part, to be a non-anxious presence to the surrounding community, pointing people towards a God of healing, a God of love, and a God who is sovereign. So Father, hear our prayers today. And Lord, we also want to pray for our partner agencies who are working in all kinds of different ministries around the world. We pray for the important work of the Barnabas Fund, who seek to support and encourage our dear brothers and sisters who are facing persecution. Equip them and lead them to those who need help. Use them to remind people of your strength and grace, Lord. We also pray for Storehouse in North Down, who seek to deliver food and care packages to those who are really struggling financially. Lord, may these gifts be received warmly, and may people be encouraged to see that ultimately they come from you. Use Storehouse to bring hope to people's lives and draw them to Jesus. We also pray for the Bible Society, who are seeking to connect people to your word. Help them to do precisely that, Father. All around the country, there are people perhaps struggling to read, perhaps struggling to understand their Bibles. So help these folks to provide resources so that people can better engage. And finally, Lord, we pray for our own church family in High Street. We thank you that despite a broken up year where we couldn't actually meet for months and months, that we've actually seen growth. We thank you for the families and the kids in particular that you've brought into our midst. Lord, may they feel welcome and at home here. And we pray that all of us would continue to grow in our love for Jesus, our understanding of your word, and our care for one another. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, folks, we turn now to God's word, and we're going to continue from where we left off a couple of weeks ago in Ephesians chapter 4. Paul had just contrasted two ways of living. On the one hand, non-believers who live separate from God, kind of slaves to their own corrupted desires. And on the other hand, then, followers of Christ who put off their old selves and put on their new selves, stepping forwards in the righteousness they were created for. So we're going to pick up this letter in verse 25 of chapter 4. So maybe you can follow along with me. Paul writes this: "Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbor, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. Anyone who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work doing something useful with their own hands, that they may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Amen. This is the word of the Lord, and thanks be to God. So, what do we do with a passage like that? Does it loom heavy on our hearts? Does it bring up feelings of guilt and shame and maybe unworthiness? Folks, the joy of the gospel is that we have been set free by Jesus's death and resurrection. That's our hope. On that cross, Jesus took our sin away. So we've been set free from the penalty of sin. We've been set free from the power of sin. But we've never been free from the presence of sin in our lives. Sin has a real hold on our hearts, always. And it's a struggle, isn't it? Every single day. What is it that the Apostle Paul says in Romans 7? I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this I keep on doing. And that's so true in my life. Recently, I watched a documentary called Free Solo. I don't know if any of you have ever seen it before. If you're afraid of heights, I definitely wouldn't recommend this. It's about a guy called Alex. And Alex attempts to climb a rock face called, or known as El Capitan in Yosemite National Park in America. It's basically a kilometer in height. And what's more, it's one of the most technically difficult walls to climb in the whole world. But get this, he wants to do it without any ropes or harness. So if he makes a single mistake, that's it. His life is over. And as I was watching this, I felt like I was on that rock face with him. Every single step was a struggle of body and mind. Every single reach, every single grip, every single inch of the climb. And in some ways, that's what life is like with our sin. It's this constant uphill struggle, and it just feels impossible to overcome. And really, actually, that's because it is. See, only Jesus could overcome it. Only Jesus lived a life without sin. And we can never hope to achieve such a thing. But by the power of the Holy Spirit who lives within the heart of a believer, God is shaping us more and more into the image of his Son. Every once in a while in our Bibles, we come across a passage like this in Ephesians 4. A list of do's and don'ts, we might say, a list of rules and commands. And sometimes people can have a negative reaction to it. They maybe think, oh, the Bible is just full of rules. And I think people say that because they wrongly assume that rules prohibit relationship. But actually, that's not the case. Rules form the basis of healthy relationship. So the Ten Commandments, for example, on one hand, just another list of rules. But on the other hand, here we have 10 instructions. God is instructing his people how to live in such a way that honors him, but also fosters a society where people are cared for and protected. And that helps form healthy relationships. Now, it's important to always be reminded in these kind of passages, when it comes to rules and commands in the Bible, it's never about our salvation. We're not Pharisees. This is not a list of stuff we have to do in order to earn God's favor and entrance into heaven. Rather, these passages of scripture are about our sanctification. God is showing his children how to live like Christ. In other words, moralism is bad, but morality is good. Morality in the Bible equates with Christ-likeness. And actually, how you respond to that challenge reveals your heart for God. So 1 John 5 says, this is love for God, that you keep his commands. So if you love God, then the law is a blessing because it's a marker that you're his child. But for those who are in opposition to God, well, the law is the enemy because it only shows that they are lawbreakers. Folks, the law is actually a gracious gift from God. It shows us how we're falling short, and it lets us know what Christ-likeness actually looks like. And remember, this passage is in the context of the verses we looked at a couple of weeks ago, where Paul says, put off your old self and put on the new, i.e. you're a changed person because of Jesus. You no longer live by your own values and ideals, rather you live by God's. And of course, none of us will ever get that right. None of us will ever be perfect. But thankfully, God does not demand that. But we can strive toward obedience. What's more, we should. So let me ask you this. What sins are you struggling with? What areas of your life need some work? Are you reflecting on your behavior or on the attitudes of your heart? And are you allowing God to search you and reveal the sinfulness within? Folks, hold on to those questions as we look at these verses together briefly. Verse 25 then, Paul encourages a transition. Stop doing one thing, but then replace it with another. So tear down something bad, but build something better in its place. And he uses this model again and again in this passage. So here in this occasion, he says, stop lying, and in its place then, start speaking truth. Now, of course, easier said than done. Our lies are usually for self-centered reasons. We lie perhaps to avoid consequences. We lie perhaps to gain advantages. And we might think our lies are justifiable sometimes, but the truth is when we lie, we're deceiving people. We're withholding truth from someone. And that is not in God's nature at all. Remember, morality equates to Christ-likeness. So do you want to be more like Jesus? Well, Jesus never lied. He only told the truth. Even when the questions were tough, even when people were angry, even if people were sad, even when his own life was on the line, he spoke truth. He never wanted to withhold things from us, and he never wanted to deceive. Now, verse 26 is an interesting one because the implication comes, it's not actually sinful to be angry. Anger can be a justified emotion in certain circumstances. For example, when we see injustice taking place, that should make us angry. But Paul says, in that anger, be sure not to let it turn into sin. And that's the problem. You see, our anger can overflow into harsh words, violent behavior, thoughts of revenge. And this is not okay. Why? Because again, it's not in God's character to do so. And the perfect example of this is Jesus himself. As he hung on that cross, as the centurions cast lots for his clothes, as the crown of thorns was pushed down into his skull, as the people gathered to ridicule and mock, Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they've done. If I was him, I would have been plotting revenge, but not Christ. He came to lay down his life because he loves us so. Paul says, don't let the anger consume you. Don't let it fester. The devil will cause your heart to harden. Your anger will lead you down a path of sin and destruction. Verse 28, then Paul again suggests stopping something and replacing it with another thing. Stop stealing. Instead, start working with your hands to help others in need. And this is brilliant because what we see here is God's heart for community. God wants us to live in community and in relationship with one another. A community of love and equality and respect, where we support, where we nurture, we encourage, and we care for each other. That's what church should look like. And of course, that means no stealing. The idea is, though, if someone has little, if someone is in need, they should be helped by someone who has plenty. That's the picture of the early church in Acts chapter 4. We're told all the believers were one in heart and mind. They shared everything they had, and there were no needy persons among them. And is this attitude not perfectly exemplified in Christ? The one who took the small lunch and shared it with 5,000 people. The one who came not to be served, but to serve others. The one who spent time with outcasts, with those who were despised. The one who laid down his life as a ransom for many. That's the character of Christ. Now, verse 29, what a challenge. Again, Paul wants us to tear something down and then build something else up that's better. And this time it's our words. No unwholesome talk, he says. Instead, speak things that build others up. And as Christians, our words should be encouraging, should be uplifting. They should be for the benefit of others. And what a privilege this is. God has given us words to use to bless. What was it that Peter said to Jesus? Lord, there is no one else we can go to because you have the words of eternal life. And folks, as Jesus' followers then, we have that same message. So maybe to those we know who are going through difficulty, going through pain, we have the words of eternal life. To those in despair or in need, we have the words of eternal life. To those without hope, we have the words of eternal life. Folks, let's not waste our time with foolish chat about unimportant things. Rather, let's keep Christ on the tip of our tongues. Let's be quick to talk about him and point others to the cross. Verse 30 then, Paul commands, do not grieve the Holy Spirit. Now, this is incredible. Do we see what this means? Paul is saying here, the Holy Spirit is grieved. That is, saddened, heartbroken, as we fail to love as we should in the Christian community. How poignant it is that the Holy Spirit, who is our comforter, is grieved by our sin. This tells us something of the heart of God. So when we go all the way back to the start of our Bibles in Genesis chapter 6, shortly after the fall of Adam and Eve, we read these verses. The Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. And then we're told this, the Lord regretted that he had made human beings on the earth. Why? Because his heart was deeply saddened. Folks, yes, God hates our sin because it's a rejection of him despite his infinite goodness and love, and he's angered by it. But he's also saddened by our sin because it leads to nothing but hurt and pain and mess. We don't know what is best for ourselves. That's why it's a blessing that God has given us the law. He gives us rules and commands in his word. He is instructing us how to live so that we are kept from harm. Finally then, in verses 31 and 32, Paul again says, stop something and replace it with something else. This time we're to cut out the bitterness, the rage, the slander, and the malice. Now, I don't know about you, but these sins are easy to fall into. I know my own heart, and it's so natural to slip into these kind of patterns. When something is really frustrating, or something doesn't go according to plan, or maybe someone is really testing your patience, it's easy to become bitter. It's easy to get overly angry, to talk badly about a person, or even desire something bad to happen to them. And I need to check my heart regularly to make sure that these patterns aren't just embedded in there without any resistance. These traits are not godly at all. And so then, as a community of Jesus followers, we ought to resemble the character of Christ. What does that look like? Well, Paul says, stop all that stuff. Instead, be kind and compassionate, forgiving others just as Christ has forgiven us. Well, easier said than done, eh? But that's the picture, folks. Let kindness abound. Let compassion flow freely. Be willing to forgive the mistakes that others make. Again, do we not see this perfectly in Jesus, the one who stood up to protect the adulterous woman despite her sin and then not condemning her, the one who embraced the tax collector Zacchaeus even though he was despised by everyone else, the one who went towards the lepers and was willing to even touch them, but that's even though they were seen as being cursed by God, the one who forgave Peter, even though he denied knowing Jesus in order to save himself, and the one who forgives all of our mistakes, the one who hung on the cross, taking the punishment that we deserved so that we could be set free from the penalty and power of sin. Folks, we said at the beginning, we're never free from the presence of sin in this lifetime. But we've got to fight. We've got to fight the good fight against sin. Let's work at our sanctification, not out of duty. Rather, it's out of love for Jesus and our appreciation for the salvation that he gives. That's the thing that drives us forwards. And of course, we do it all with the help of the Holy Spirit. He pushes us along that path of holiness, continually conforming us into the likeness of Christ, the Son of God. Amen. Well, we want to respond a little bit to what God has been laying on our hearts here this morning. Let's not just kind of get up and walk away from this unchanged. We all have areas of our lives where we need God's grace. Perhaps we have anger in our hearts. Perhaps we struggle with lies and deceit. Perhaps we're guilty of unwholesome talk. Perhaps we fall into the trap of slander or malice. Whatever our weaknesses, let's allow God to search our hearts. Let's surrender over to Jesus's lordship. Let's not hold back some parts for ourselves. And maybe let's recommit as followers of Christ today, ready and willing to strive for holiness with the help of the Holy Spirit. And as we do this, we'll sing together the wonderful praise song, 10,000 Reasons.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Holy name, sing like never.
Folks, that is us for this morning. Thank you for tuning in, joining in as we worshipped the Lord together. Hopefully we'll see you in person next Sunday. You're welcome to come along to our church building where we meet each week. Otherwise, we'll be back online here next Sunday. And also just a reminder about Wednesday night, our prayer meeting online at 7:30. Details to follow. We thank you, and we'll finish by sharing the grace with one another. So may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all forevermore. Amen.